Thanks to technicians, thanks to Amin for inviting me to this Congress, and I want to spend some words about the possibility that a specific psychopathology of substance use disorder exists. And if it exists, we must include also the emotional responses to life events. In my opinion, it's not possible that from a neurobiological point of view, only craving and relapse can characterize substance use disorder, because we have a specific psychopathology of depression, we have a specific psychopathology of schizophrenia, but we don't have at present a specific psychopathology of addiction. Like addicted people don't have emotion or error in the emotion. This is not possible in my view. And some years ago, we tried to delineate the psychic structure of substance abuse and addiction as a proposal for DSM-5, but of course they refused. And fortunately, they refused because we are resilient and we continued to study this kind of problem. And when we speak about a specific psychopathology of addiction, we speak about some part of anxiety, some part of mood, some part of impulse control, dysregulation. This is our vision. Yes, we have pre-existing factor to addiction, and we have the substance effects, but we have also the addictive processes that from clinical point is craving and relapse. But we have the psychiatric consequences, but we think that at this point it's possible to have a specific psychopathology of substance use disorder. In fact, if we don't consider the possibility of a specific psychopathology of substance use disorder, it's possible to have an erroneous estimation of comorbidity. So we started to study the mental status of our patient coming for agonist opioid treatment to the dual diagnosis unit at the psychiatric clinic at the University of Pisa. And we try to study the clinical presentation of our patients, and they arrived to the treatment with a dimension characterized by depressive and anxious symptoms, psychomotor excitement, and the psychotic states. But the relationship between depressive anxious dual diagnosis and the presence of a dual diagnosis is quite absent and is very pronounced for psychomotor excitement and psychotic state. So depression is really the most frequent clinical picture of heroin addict looking for treatment, but depression is not indicative of the presence of a dual diagnosis. So it's possible that some kind of depression is specific to be addicted, not to be depressed and addicted. And so we try to study what happens when patients arrive to the treatment, and we used a very simple self-report symptom inventory, SEL-90, and the first difference is that when we use this checklist in psychiatric patients, we have this kind of factorialization, but when we use this kind of test, of checklist, in addicted patients, especially heroin use disorder patients, we have five factor demensialization. Worthlessness be strapped is the most important with the load, the highest load. The second is a somatic symptom. The third is sensitivity psychoticism, panic anxiety, and violence suicide. Of course, in SCL90, somatic symptom is very similar to a withdrawal symptomatology, especially in heroin use disorder patients. So it's possible to study the T score of our sample, our standardization sample. It's possible to divide, to typify all patients arriving to the treatment in one of these subgroup. And as you can see, these groups are equally represented in our standardization sample. And it's possible to study the standard deviation from the standardization group, what is the prominent characteristic of our patients. In this case, our patients is characterized by worthlessness being trapped. So we can typify all patients, and this is important, especially as I will show you at the end of my presentation at the treatment level. So we start to demonstrate, we started to demonstrate the stability of our dimensions. There is a stability, there is a trait and not a state dimension, because these five dimensions are independent of the choice of a treatment. It's the same for people arriving to agonist opioid treatment and the people going to the therapeutic community. It's independent of active substance use in detoxify or non-detoxify patients entering therapeutic community. Independent of the lifetime psychiatric problems, is independent of the choice of substance used, heroin, alcohol, or cocaine, also when this kind of substances are mixed, and is independent also when we consider only mono user patients. At the same time, these dimensions are strictly correlated to addictive behaviors and they are strictly correlated to stress sensitivity. It's possible, using this kind of psychopathological typology, to differentiate patients with other psychopathological dimensions. It's possible to differentiate patients affected by major depression very well. It's possible to partially discriminate people with obesity, non-psychiatric patient people with obesity, and it's not possible to differentiate patients with gambling. So is a specific psychopathology, what we found. But if we can consider worthlessness being trapped in the mood dysregulation and panic anxiety dimension in anxiety dysregulation, and the violence and suicide and the impulse control dysregulation with a less explicative sounds about this kind of dimension, what we can say about stress sensitivity. In our clinic in Pisa, we started many years ago to study the trauma and loss spectrum. That is a kind to evaluate symptomatology very similar to what present in post-traumatic stress disorder, but related to the loss and stress and life events. And we called these symptoms loss spectrum, trauma and loss spectrum, because it's possible to study also in people without a post-traumatic stress disorder. And we started to study this kind of reaction before and after the dependence age of onset of our patients. And we found that loss event and life event are more represented after the age of onset of heroin addiction. And you can see that the area is more represented the area after the age of onset of heroin addiction. So we started to answer these questions. Are correlation between PTSD spectrum and severity of heroin addiction significant? Are opioid medication able to reduce reaction to life events? And as you can see, the answer is yes, it's possible for the severity of the stage, for the severity of opioid abuse, for the long history of heroin addiction, and not for the use of heroin per se. But more interestingly, from our point of view, is that people with more opioid medication dosage are less of these reaction to life events. Can heroin addiction generate a sort of PTSD without traumatic events? We studied in our clinic the survival to earthquake of L'Aquila in Italy, and we can found that people with more than 32 points to the PTSD spectrum had a symptomatology like people developing PTSD after the earthquake in L'Aquila. And if you consider the number of people with the spectrum of PTSD in long-lasting heroin use patients and in PTSD earthquake survival, the number, there is no difference. The difference is with no PTSD survivors. And you can see that the differences are evident between no PTSD and patients with heroin addiction and people developing PTSD after the earthquake. So it's possible to have the same emotional reaction being heroin addicts and being survivor with a PTSD after a big event. And it's possible to consider this kind of reaction to life events as part of the psychopathology of heroin addiction. This is really important because we haven't a point to decide when to stop treatment, because the illness is a chronic illness, but the treatment is limited in time, generally, especially treatment with agonist opioid medication. So when we are able to say, yes, we can stop the treatment. When the psychopathology is very low? Probably. When the reaction to stress is compensated? Probably. We don't know, but I think it's important to know this kind of answer. The psychopathology of heroin use disorder is strictly correlated to stress sensitivity. This is a canonical correlation significant, and is independent of the emotional responses to life events. This is people with a high PTSD spectrum, and this is people with a low PTSD spectrum, and there is no a significant difference in typology of psychopathology. Two words about treatment, because we are not sure that methadone and buprenorphine have the same impact on psychopathological symptoms of heroin addicts. We demonstrate that people with the dual diagnosis or dual disorder have the same results if treated, well treated in an agonist opioid treatment. And we demonstrate this for bipolar 1 patients. And we demonstrate now this for patients with psychosis. These are patients with the dual disorder bipolar 1, dual disorder psychosis during an enhanced agonist opioid treatment. But you can see it's also important the treatment, the response to the treatment according to the typology of psychopathology. There is no difference in methadone and buprenorphine regarding these three characteristics: worthlessness, being trapped, the somatic symptom, and panic anxiety. But there is a big difference in sensitivity, psychosis, and violence suicide. Methadone is no good for violence suicide. Buprenorphine is no good, is less good in sensitivity, psychoticism, prominent characteristics of our patients. This is not the severity of a symptom, is the prominent characteristic, is the typology. This kind of symptomatology is prominent on the other. And you can see violence suicide is the poor results also for people entering therapeutic community. So if we have a patient with a prominent characteristic, violence suicide, is not good to put him in therapeutic community, and is better to use buprenorphine for the treatment with the agonist opioid treatment. So you can see the high rate of psychiatric symptom among heroin addicts cannot be overlooked or under-evaluated. Probably this symptom can characterize patients independently from intoxication, psychiatric severity, and concomitant and other kind of substance abuse. Probably this symptom can influence treatment outcome, and probably therapeutic opioids are effective on these symptoms. So therapeutic opioids are psychoactive substances and must be considered as antidepressant, antipsychotic in our patients, like medications also for psychopathological symptoms, not only for addiction to opioids. Probably psychiatric condition predict outcome in methadone or buprenorphine treated patients, and probably treating heroin addiction with a therapeutic opioid, we can treat psychiatric comorbidity. And this is the opposite when I started to treat patients with the dual disorder, in which the presence of psychiatric comorbidity was no good prognostic factor for our patients. Now I think it's possible to improve the outcome of our dual disorder patients, enhancing the treatment for the dependents. Thank you very much for your attention.